So today our journey will take us to the galaxies. We will start with the galaxy in which we live and then move to the most distant galaxies, which are at the edge of the universe as we understand today. So let us start with our galaxy, the Milky Way. This might surprise you, but when the last century began, people had no idea how big our galaxy was, and indeed how big our universe was. The prevalent view at that time was that our galaxy was indeed the whole universe. And how big was our galaxy? Well, in the year 1922, Kapteyn, a very distinguished Dutch astronomer, made a map of the sky, and he mapped our galaxy to be like this, a very small object, only about 20,000 light years in radius, if you like, and most disturbingly, we were at the center of this galaxy. And this galaxy was the whole universe, and this was called Kapteyn's universe. So, believe it or not, in 1922, we believed our universe was only about 50,000 light years across. And what Kapteyn didn't know was about dust in the galaxy. And because of extinction by dust, he could not see the more distant objects. A major breakthrough was made when Henrietta Leavitt made a very extremely important discovery in the year 1908. She was working in the Harvard Observatory, and her discovery enabled one to determine distances to certain special kinds of stars, and that revolutionized astronomy. So before going back to that slide, let us briefly recall the spectacular discovery she made. What is shown on the top is the light curve, or the brightness, of certain type of stars which are called Cepheid. They are called Cepheid variables because the light they emit varies in intensity periodically, as shown in the top. Now what is shown in the bottom is a relation between their luminosity, that means their intrinsic brightness, plotted as a function of the period of oscillation in the x-axis. And you notice that the luminosity and period have a linear relationship. This means that if I detect a Cepheid variable, I measure its apparent brightness, and then if I measure the period of oscillation, then this bottom picture enables me to calculate what its luminosity is. And since I know the luminosity and the apparent brightness, then by inverse square law, I know the distance to it. There are another kind of variable stars, which are called RR Lyrae variables. And they also have a period luminosity relationship, but rather a subtle one. And in fact, their luminosity is more or less independent of their period. So they're like standard candles. Now let's go back to the previous slide. What Hubble did in 1923 was to discover one of these Cepheid variables in the Andromeda Nebula. At that time, people believed the Andromeda Nebula was part of our galaxy. Using Henrietta Leavitt's relationship, Hubble discovered that the distance to the Andromeda Nebula, or the distance to the Cepheid star, was 3 million light years, which was a lot more than 50,000 light years, which is the size of our galaxy as estimated by Kapteyn. And that is how Hubble came to the conclusion that the universe has lots and lots of galaxies, and today we know there are billions and billions of galaxies. But let's come back to our story. In our galaxy, there are what are known as globular clusters, such as you see one here. These typically contain about 1 million stars, each gravitationally bound to a self-consistent gravitational potential, and they are in elliptical orbits about the center of mass. And these globular clusters have in them some of these RR Leidy stars. The famous astronomer Harlow Shapley in Harvard used these RR Leidy stars and Henrietta Leavitt's discovery to determine distances to these globular clusters. And then he plotted the distribution of the globular clusters in our galaxy. And what is shown here is the distribution of the globular clusters in our galaxy. The two axes represent the distance from the Sun, which is at the origin in this coordinate system. And quite clearly, we were not at the center of this system of globular clusters. What Harlow Shapley did was, spectroscopically, he determined the dynamical center of this distribution of globular clusters in the galaxy. And that dynamical center is indicated by the cross on the x-axis in this slide. So quite clearly, what globular cluster said was that this dynamical center must be identified with the dynamical center of our galaxy, because after all, the globular clusters are moving in elliptical orbits about the center of our galaxy. And therefore, it became clear that we are not at the center of the universe, thank God. But you notice a fortuitous circumstance here. We said Captain made a mistake because he didn't know about extinction. Most of the stars that you see are very close to the disk of the galaxy, as we will see now. But these globular clusters are far from the disk of the galaxy, and therefore they do not suffer from extinction. So quite by accident, Harlow Shapley picked the kind of objects which are not affected by dust, and therefore his discovery was not erroneous because of the absence of knowledge about dust in our galaxy. So the model of the galaxy that was soon accepted is shown in this cartoon in this slide. The galaxy has a flat disk, and in the center there is a bulge. We, the solar system, are about 30,000 years from the center, dynamical center of the galaxy. The physical size of our galaxy is a lot larger than Captain imagined. It's about 100,000 light years across. Now let us look at these different components of the galaxy a little more carefully. What is shown here is the bulge of the galaxy, and what you see as diffuse white light are actually stars, which cannot be resolved. And then there is a flat disk, a relatively flat disk. And then there is a dark band, which of course is the dust, which we talked about in the previous lecture. The stars in the bulge of the galaxy, like the globular clusters, which you see over there in the slide, away from the plane of the galaxy, similar, just as they are in elliptical orbits, like electrons in an atom, around the center of the galaxy, so are the stars in the bulge in elliptical orbits around the center of the galaxy. But the stars in the disk of the galaxy are in near circular motion around the center of the galaxy, but they are not strictly circular motion because the disk is not infinitely thin, It has a certain thickness, therefore there is a gravitational potential in the z direction also. So the stars going up and down the plane and at the same time executing an orbit around. And because of this, the orbit is not closed like in Newtonian mechanics. The orbits in Newtonian mechanics are closed. Here the orbit will not be closed because this here you have a gravitational potential which is a function of x, y and z. Now let us look at the disk of the galaxy first. It is rather thin. It is roughly circular disk of stars with a coherent rotation. We'll come to the rotation presently. And there are about 2 × 10^10 stars in the disk of the galaxy, amounting to a total mass of about 6 × 10^9 solar masses. The density of stars in the disk decreases as you go away from the center of the galaxy. It can be modeled as an exponential decrease with the scale height e^r/h, which is a scale height, which is about 3,000 parsecs or 9,000 light years. Okay, so that's the exponential decay constant. Most of the stars, or 95% of them, are within about 300 parsecs, and the rest of the thick disk, the disk consists of a very thin disk, which are the massive stars, and then it consists of a thick disk of stars which are migrated away from their birthplaces due to stellar collisions, and these are the less massive stars. So the disk is a thick component as well as a thin component. And there is also gas in the disk, as we saw, atomic gas and molecular gas. Now let us look at the bulge. It is right there at the center. These are very old stars, born when the galaxy itself was formed. And it has about 5 × 10^9 solar masses. It's 2 × 10^10 solar masses. And its luminosity is about 5 × 10^9 solar masses. So that means most of the stars in the bulge have roughly the solar luminosity. Now, in addition to the bulge and the disk, there is also the halo. We saw, if you go back to the 2 slides before, you see there is a halo. There are stars everywhere. And what is the nature of this halo? The halo consists of stars. These stars are very, very old. They are very metal poor. In astronomy, metal is anything heavier than carbon, which means these are low mass stars whose stellar evolution did not proceed very much beyond helium fusing to carbon, and the story stopped there. The stellar drama, the curtains came down. That's why they are poor in the heavier elements. And they have random motions. In other words, they are not rotationally supported like the stars in the disk. So they form elliptical orbits like electrons in an atom or molecule. Then, of course, there are these globular clusters which Harlow Shapley had used as tracers to map the gravitational potential of the galaxy. And there is some gas, and this gas is at about 100,000 degrees to 1,000,000 degrees and seen mainly emitting ultraviolet and soft X-rays. Obviously, this gas was discovered in very recent times. It was not known before. And then, of course, as we will see, there is dark matter. So that's the nature of the halo of the galaxy. Walter Bade, of a neutron star frame and the Crab Nebula fame, made another very important discovery by studying the Andromeda galaxy. Namely, that our galaxy, there are 2 populations of stars, and very imaginatively, they are called population 1 and population 2. Population 1 stars include the Sun and the more luminous stars. These are hot, young, relatively young object, concentrated mainly in the disk of the galaxy. They are found primarily in the spiral arms of the galaxy. Now, with the model of heavy element formation and supernovae, somebody asked me the question earlier, how do we form elements heavier than iron? And I answered that these are formed during the explosion of stars by neutron capture reactions, right? Now, this suggests that the gas from which these stars formed were previously processed in stars and returned to the interstellar medium when those stars exploded. So the fact that the population 1 stars have heavy elements, like in our body on Earth, tells us that the material from which the solar system was formed was enriched by many generations of birth and death of stars. In contrast, the population 2 stars are mainly found in globular clusters and in the very central regions of the galaxy, in the bulge. They tend to be older, less luminous and cooler than population 1 stars, and they also are not very rich in the heavy elements, either by being older or being in regions where no heavy element producing predecessors could be found. In other words, even in the past, the bulge did not have massive stars, and therefore the interstellar medium in the bulge never had heavy elements. Therefore, the population 2 stars are metal poor. Remember, metallicity in astronomy means heavier than about carbon or so. All right. We are not going to discuss this, but the red is a closed circle you would expect from Newtonian mechanics. But what is shown in black is the typical trajectory of a star around the center of the galaxy. It's a very complicated problem. We will not discuss that. Now let us turn to something else. It was noticed by the Swedish astronomer Bertin Lindblad, was also a very powerful mathematician, that in our galaxy, if you look in a certain direction, you see a lot of large velocity of stars. You see stars moving with large velocities with respect to the local standard of rest, which I introduced last time. Now, what is interesting about these high-velocity stars is they're all moving in the same direction. From this, what Lindblad deduced was something very spectacular. Lindblad deduced that the Sun and the other disk stars in the local standard of rest are rotating around the center of the galaxy a little faster. Therefore, it will appear to me all of you are moving in this direction. It's not that you people are all moving in this direction. You're all moving at random in this room. But I am going a little faster than you around the center of the galaxy. And therefore, it will appear to me that you are moving in a systematic fashion in this direction. From this, Bertil Lindblad deduced that our galaxy must be rotating differentially and not like a rigid body. You'll agree, it's a very clever deduction from a very simple observation. Please remember that when you look at the sky, the motion of stars, it is quite random. And to deduce from that some systematic motions is not like in the slide that I showed you. That is a slide drawn by me. That's not what the real observations would be. That's why you must always pause to think how brilliant these people were to draw these deductions from data which was incredibly noisy. Right? So that's the picture of the differential rotation of our galaxy. Now, what is shown here is something we won't dwell on. I just want you to appreciate that by symmetry, the projection of any velocity vector in the radial direction towards us or away from us will show a double sine wave. Okay? So you'll find sine of the, you won't find sine of the longitude, where longitude goes from 0, 90, 180, 270, and 0. You'll find sine of twice the longitude. And I've just tried to show that by symmetry, 45 degrees and 315 degrees are equivalent, 135, 225 are equivalent. So we won't dwell on that. You think about it and you'll come to this conclusion. So let's get on with the story. In 1927, Jan Oort, later on persuaded his student Van de Hulst to investigate the possibility of detecting the hyperfine transition of hydrogen ground state, but that was in the 1940s. Is the same Jan Oort in 1927. He lived to be 92 years old, and he was incredibly productive till the very last month. Okay? One of those very rare scientists was productive throughout his life. He put Bertil Lindblad's assumption or deduction of differential rotation of the galaxy on a little more sound footing. And that is shown on the top there. What is shown on the, in the first equation is the radial velocity of a star in the direction towards us. Okay? Obviously, the radial velocity will depend upon how far the star is from us, because the galaxy is now differentially rotating. Therefore, you see in that equation, the radial velocity is A, which is some constant, D, which is the distance between the star and me, and sine of 2L, where L is the galactic longitude, which goes from 0 to 360 degrees. Second equation is the ratio of the transverse velocity to the distance, which astronomers call proper motion. It is the actual proper motion of the object in the sky. And that is equal to A cos 2L plus B. You can write down these expressions very easily if you draw a picture like this and have a little bit of patience. We'll skip that. I merely want to draw your attention to the fact that the coefficients A and B, which are today known as Oort's constants, are of two kinds. Let theta be the orbital circular velocity of a star around the center of the galaxy. Omega is the angular velocity. So you notice that the Oort's constant A is minus a half R d omega by dr. It tells you how the rotational angular velocity changes with the radius. In other words, it tells you about the shear of our galaxy. The second constant B, Oort's constant B, is 2 omega plus R d omega by dr. Convince yourself by drawing a little picture, this represents vorticity. So the differential rotation of our galaxy as a function of distance from the sun can be described by a shear and a vorticity, or in other words, Oort's constant A and Oort's constant B. Obviously, this is only valid in the solar neighborhood. Of course, 30 years later, the hydrogen gas was found, and then, as we will see, you can now dispense with Oort's constant and do an observation right to the edge of the galaxy. What are the magnitudes of the Oort's constant A and B? But before that, you look at the two expressions for A and B. If I now subtract B from A minus B, I get omega sun. Okay, all those things are evaluated at the galactic radius at which the sun is present, okay? R subscript sun. So A minus B is the angular velocity of the sun around the center of the galaxy. Oort, in 1927, estimated that Oort's constant A is 30 kilometers per second per kiloparsec. In other words, the velocity changes with distance because of the differential rotation. It's about 30 kilometers per second per kiloparsec, and Oort's constant B is minus 10 kilometers per second per kiloparsec. The modern value is 14.8 for constant A and minus 12.4 for constant B. So you notice that Oort did a pretty good job in 1927. So if I subtract B from A, I get for the orbital velocity of the Sun around the center of the galaxy as 220 kilometers per second. So we are going around the Sun with a velocity of 30 kilometers per second, and the solar system is going around the center of the galaxy with a velocity of 220 kilometers per second. Now, just to give you an idea how big our galaxy is, if you take the best rockets that we have today, it will take us 10 billion years to go around the center of the galaxy. Okay, the Sun will go around the center of the galaxy in about 250, 230 million years. So that tells you how big our galaxy is. Okay? Now let us go from our local neighborhood to large-scale differential rotation. As I said, any determination of the large-scale differential rotation had to wait till the discovery of the hyperfine 21-centimeter radiation from the hydrogen atom. How is this done? How do we model the rotation of the galaxy using the 21-centimeter radiation? What an astronomer actually measures in some given direction is the intensity of the emission, hydrogen emission, plotted as a function of the radial velocity with respect to the local standard of rest to which we belong. And what you will find, let us say, is a curve which is delineated by these red dots. The first thing an astronomer will try to do is to try to fit Gaussians to it, to see how many discrete features this can be broken up into. And these discrete features will be identified with individual hydrogen clouds at different distances. So I have shown here in these black Gaussians the modeling of such an observation. We won't get into that. Now let us say that after the modeling, our observations tell us, look at the right-hand top corner, observations tell us that there are primarily four Gaussians. Purple, red, blue, and green. They are at different velocities, radial velocities. And in particular, the red Gaussian is at zero radial velocity, in which, by that I mean, it has relative to us zero radial velocity. For example, a gas inside which I am sitting will have zero velocity with respect to me. One other situation. So let us look at this graph that I have drawn with some effort carefully. There is the center of our galaxy, and there is the Sun. The distance between the center of the galaxy and the Sun is written as R subscript Sun. And then there are clouds, these red dots, blue dots, green dots, blue dot, red dot, magenta dots, are different hydrogen clouds at different distances in that particular longitude in which I happen to be looking. And that longitude is L. To be any longitude, I'm looking at L. Therefore, this green cloud, for example, is at a distance R from the center of the galaxy, which is equal to R Sun multiplied by the sine of the longitude. Why is that? Because in that particular longitude, my line of sight, which is a black line, is tangent to the green circle. It happens to be tangent to the green circle. Therefore, that angle is 90 degrees. Now, let us look at all the hydrogen clouds. Let us look at the red hydrogen cloud, which is next to us. And let us look at the another hydrogen cloud, which is on this dotted red circle. The dotted red circle is the imaginary circle on which the sun goes around the center of the galaxy. Since the two red clouds are on the same circle, they will have the same circular velocity and the same angular velocity, and therefore the radial velocity will be zero. Therefore, these two red clouds will come at zero velocity. Now let us look at the blue cloud. There is one here and one here. The blue cloud is moving faster around the center of the galaxy than we are moving, differential rotation. Therefore, the radial velocity projected, that blue arrow projected onto the line of sight, will be a positive number. Therefore, both these blue clouds will appear with a positive radial velocity, and I cannot tell by observations whether it is that blue cloud or that blue cloud. Similarly, I cannot tell by observation whether it is that red cloud or that red cloud. So there is a distance ambiguity which can be resolved by other observations. Okay. Now let us look at a cloud on the magenta circle. Let us say a cloud over there that is going slower than us around the center of the galaxy. Therefore, the radial velocity of that will, projected radial velocity will be negative. Therefore, you see, from a given observation in a particular longitude, I can make all these deductions. The most important deduction is that there is a tangent point, and that green dot is the tangent point, and that has the maximum radial velocity. Okay, so I point my telescope in some arbitrary direction. I don't care about all the other clouds, but I pick that one cloud which has the maximum radial velocity, and I know exactly where that is in the galaxy. Now I do it for another longitude. I do it for another longitude. So if I do it for all the longitude, then I can get these tangent points. Unfortunately, if I look away from the center of the galaxy, there are no tangent points. And therefore, I cannot make this kind of a clever deduction. So I have to resort to some other method to deduce the nature of the rotation law in the outer part of the galaxy. Okay? So that's how the detailed modeling of the rotation of the galaxy is deduced from 21 centimeter observations. And I hope this is clear to you. So, by doing such observations at all longitudes, astronomers have been able to reconstruct the distribution of neutral hydrogen in the galaxy. This method also provides us with the rotation curve of the galaxy, namely how the angular velocity changes with distance from the center of the galaxy. Now, as I said, to emphasize once again, this method can be used only inside the solar circle because there are no tangent points outside the solar circle. Now, this rotation curve has been extended to distances beyond the sun in the galaxy, but by doing something slightly indirect. What you do, remember from the last lecture, you have molecular clouds. At the surface of molecular clouds, you have these blisters, which are the newly formed stars. And the hydrogen gas near the stars are glowing due to recombination. So imagine that I'm looking away from the center of the galaxy is over there, and I'm looking in that direction. I find a giant molecular cloud. I measure the velocity using the carbon monoxide J equal to 1 to J equal to 0. But I don't know how far that molecular cloud is, but I know how to estimate the distance to the star which is sitting on the surface of the molecular cloud. Therefore, by putting these two observations together, I have an indirect, slightly approximate distance determination to the molecular cloud. So inside the solar circle, I use hydrogen clouds. Outside the solar circle, I use carbon monoxide. But the method is the same. I measure the radial velocity. So the rotation curve of a galaxy was determined, and that is shown, for example, in the bottom picture, up to a distance of 15,000 parsecs from the center of the galaxy. Now, the first thing to notice is that the rotation curve is more or less flat, and in particular, it is flat near our neighborhood. We'll go back to that picture in a minute, but this is something that we should have anticipated a long time ago, in 1927 itself. Let's go back and revisit our Oort's constant A and B, which I have written here for ready reference. I said before, A minus B is the angular velocity of the sun around the center of the galaxy. Now let us construct A plus B. A plus B will give me d theta by dr, where theta is the circular velocity, not the angular velocity, circular velocity. Now, 14.8 plus minus 12.4 is very nearly zero. So already in 1927, we should have known that A plus B is very nearly zero. That means that the circular velocity in our neighborhood is not changing with respect to distance far towards the center of the sun. In other words, the law of rotation should be flat. And that's what we find in observations. So you see the rotation curve has two parts. In the central regions of the galaxy, the rotation curve, the velocity is increasing with distance. And after a while, it becomes a constant. And that is where we are, about 8 or 10,000 parsecs from the center of the galaxy. And it continues to be flat. Now, the rotation curve of a galaxy has been deduced more recently to very large distances. Here it is 100,000 light years. Here it's only 15,000 light years. And it's still flat. If anything, it is rising and not falling. What does this mean? And that is shown in this diagram. Let us first look at this circle here on the bottom left. There is a sphere of uniform density, and that is rotating differentially. So it is very obvious, you know, from that is shown in this box there, gmm over r squared is equal to mv squared by r. At every distance small r inside this shaded sphere. Therefore, the orbital velocity, if you work it out, is going to linearly increase with the distance r as r small r divided by capital R. So go to the top picture now that tells you in the inner part of the galaxy, which is rotating rigidly, the radial the circular velocity as a function of distance will increase linearly. But outside of the sphere of uniform density, the circular velocity will decrease according to Newton or Kepler's laws as 1 over square root of r. And that is shown over here. So what you would expect from very simple considerations is that in the innermost regions of the galaxy, which is rotating rigidly, the circular velocity will increase linearly and then decrease as 1 over square root of r according to Kepler's laws. But that's not what you find. Now, look at this visual picture of the galaxy, and the coordinate system is centered at the center of the galaxy. You notice that the visual galaxy more or less ends here, And therefore, what you would expect for the rotation curve is inside the visual extent of the galaxy, the rotation curve should increase and then decrease as 1 over square root of r. But observations tell us that it continues to increase. And this is not just in our galaxy or one or two other galaxies. This has been observed now in hundreds and hundreds of galaxies using the GMRT, for example, which is 21 centimeter receivers. So you find that the rotation curve is flat up to very large distances. The physical size of the galaxy is only about 10 or 15 kiloparsec. The rotation curve remains flat up to 50, 100, 150 kiloparsecs in many galaxies. What does this mean? What does Newton's law actually tell us? It tells us G, mass contained within the radius R, Gm less than R, mass of the test particle, Gmm over R squared is equal to mv squared by R, which gives us for the velocity square root of Gm over R. What we are finding is that this velocity does not decrease as 1 over square root of r, but the velocity is a constant. What that means is the numerator inside the square root sign must also increase linearly with distance. In other words, m of r must be proportional to r, which is shown in this red box there. So, although visually the galaxy has ended, this rotation curve tells us that the mass of the galaxy continues to increase linearly with distance. That means there must be matter outside the visual extent of the galaxy, and this matter is dark. This is the famous dark matter in the universe, okay? So out of these observations that were done first in our galaxy, Vera Rubin, she is the pioneer in this. She died just about a month or two ago. And many people feel, and I'm one of them, I knew her very well for a very long time, feel that she should have been given the Nobel Prize for this discovery a long time ago. But that was not to be. And now it doesn't matter. The model of a galaxy, all galaxies now, is that everything that I spoke about in the beginning, deduced from Shapley's observation, is just the center of a super massive halo consisting of dark matter, about which we know very little, except its gravitational influence. Now, I want you to appreciate at this stage that not all galaxies are like our galaxy. In the last lecture I showed you, from 21 centimeter observation, we have deduced spiral structure of our galaxies, just like in Andromeda and so many other galaxies. But not all galaxies have spiral structures. Some galaxies are like football. These are known as elliptical galaxies. All this white light that you see are actually stars, unresolved stars. Now, I've shown here examples of three giant elliptical galaxies, and we'll return to these giant elliptical galaxies presently. Now, unlike spiral galaxies, these elliptical galaxies do not have any gas in them. And the stars are all old, low-mass stars, like the stars in the globular clusters of our galaxy or the stars in the bulge of our galaxy. They are metal-poor, very old, low-mass stars. Therefore, there is very little supernova activity in these galaxies. You don't have supernova like Tycho supernova, Kepler supernova, or the Crab Nebula. Those are all explosions of massive stars. There are no massive stars here. There is no gas. There are occasionally supernovae, and these are supernovae in which a white dwarf is pushed over the Chandrasekhar limit. And we will return to that in the last lecture of this series. These are called type 1 a supernova where two things could happen. A white dwarf accretes matter, and then its mass increases beyond the Chandrasekhar limit, collapses, which is unlikely. A more plausible explanation is two white dwarfs are going around each other around a common center of mass. Their orbit spirals in due to gravitational radiation, and after billions and billions of years, they coalesce, and mass exceeds the Chandrasekhar limit, and you have a supernova explosion. Such supernovae are seen in these elliptical galaxies, and they have turned out to be extremely important tools which has enabled us to deduce that our universe is in fact accelerating. We will come to that in the last lecture. Long time ago, Hubble drew this tuning fork diagram where what you see are pictures of real galaxies. You see, these are the elliptical galaxies, and these elliptical galaxies, some are spheroidal, some are ellipsoidal, and you see spiral galaxies. These spiral galaxies don't have a central bar, whereas these spiral galaxies, right near the center, there is a bar. So spiral galaxies also can be distinguished. And so Hubble drew a tuning fork diagram, and the question arises, how did these different morphologies arise? Did spiral galaxies become elliptical galaxies, or were they formed in a very different way? This question is not entirely resolved, and I do not have time to digress into the story at this stage. I merely wanted you to appreciate that not all galaxies are spiral galaxies. In fact, for the story that I am now about to embark on, the most important galaxies are these elliptical galaxies, these seemingly uninteresting galaxies in which there is no interstellar medium, there is no star formation, there is no supernova activity, or is where the real action is. Okay, so we will come to that in a minute. And that will take us to the subject of radio galaxies and quasars. These are at very large distances. The most distant radio galaxies and quasars now have been detected at a redshift of 6. That means the universe was only about 750,000 years old at that time. And that raises profound questions. Now let us go back to the discovery of the radio galaxies. The first radio galaxy discovered was the galaxy Cygnus A in the constellation Cygnus, the Swan. You remember when I told you the story of the Crab Nebula? John Bolton, using the Cliff interferometer in Sydney, Yagi antenna, by constructing an interferometer using the reflected radiation from the sea, was able to, because the angular resolution enabled, because it was an interferometer, he was able to have enough angular resolution to say that the radio radiation was coming from the Crab Nebula. Two of his associates in Australia at the time, three of them, Hay, Parsons, and Phillips, used the same Sydney interferometer to deduce radio emission from one other object besides the Crab Nebula, and that was in the constellation Cygnus. And these two discoveries really shook people more than the Crab Nebula, which pretty soon people had identified from Chinese historical records with a supernova of 1054 AD. So you can expect all kinds of exotic things in a supernova, but radio emission from a constellation Cygnus? Around that time, in 1953, four years after that, Jennison and Dasgupta, they were students of Hanbury Brown, the great Hanbury Brown, you might have heard of him. They were using an improvised interferometer in Manchester. They were both students in Manchester. What they did was, there was one radio telescope in Manchester, other was on a Jeep, and you drive around in the Jeep, and then you have an interferometer. And of course, there were no electronic data. There were these chart recorders. Then you come back to the lab, spread the chart recorders, and see if there are correlations. They found there were a correlation of intensities. Okay? So here is a problem for you. Page 1, paragraph 1 of any book on quantum mechanics tells you that if I have a double slit, if I try to detect whether the photon went through this slit or that slit, the interference will disappear. It's a violation of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. Now, in a radio interferometer, you not only detect, you don't detect amplitudes, you detect intensities, and you put it through an amplifier, you amplify the signal, and then you correlate the intensities, and you produce fringes. Is this not a violation of Heisenberg's uncertainty principle? Radio astronomers do it all the time. Jennison and Dasgupta did it. Nobody could care less. Then Hanbury Brown said, I'm going to go and do it in optical. And because I'm going to correlate intensities, I don't need fancy mirrors. People had a lot of searchlight mirrors around. They were built to detect the German planes which were bombing England. Anti-aircraft searchlights. So Hanbury Brown went around the bazaar buying old abandoned mirrors and put them on a ship and said, I'm going to Australia and I'm going to build a big interferometer. And unlike Michelson, I'm not going to be bothered with amplitudes. I'll measure intensities and add them. And then on the way, he stopped in Caltech and he ran into Feynman. He said, where are you going? I'm going to Australia. What for? I'm going to measure intensities of stars and measure their angular diameter. Can't be done. Violates quantum mechanics, said Feynman. And then an hour later, he comes back and says, it'll work. So about 500 papers were written proving that Hanbury Brown's idea will not work because it's a violation of quantum mechanics. He couldn't care less. He said, if I can do it in radio, I can do it in optical. They're all solutions of Maxwell's equations. And then the paper appeared in Nature, along with a paper by Purcell, the same Purcell as 21 centimeter radiation I spoke about in the last lecture. I remember the first sentence of Purcell's paper by heart. The intensity interferometer of Hanbury, Brown, and Twiss is not only not a violation of quantum mechanics, but an illustration of one of its elementary principles. And then when Feynman wrote the book on, I forget the name of the book, Problem 1, Chapter 1 was intensity interferometers. So you think of it, how come an intensity interferometer does not violate Heisenberg's uncertainty principle? So let's get back to the story. What Jennison and Dasgupta did was able to achieve enough angular resolution to show that the radio emission from constellation Cygnus actually consists of two sources. It was a double source. And that shocked people even more. So once the position of this source was available, Walter Bade and Minkowski in Caltech identified it with an optical galaxy, which is Cygnus, the galaxy Cygnus. And thus it came about that the radio emission from a galaxy was discovered for the very first time. Of course, radio emission from our galaxy was known, but to detect a radio emission from some distant galaxy is a very different thing altogether. Now, this discovery of a radio galaxy created an unbelievable amount of buzz in astronomy. And then Sir Martin Ryle in Cambridge in the Cavendish Laboratory built an interferometer which was 1 mile long and produced this map of Cygnus A. It consists of two lobes of radio emission, and right at the center was Minkowski and Bade's optical galaxy. Now, I do not have time to go and tell you about something very important that happened in this phase of astronomy, for which Martin Ryle was to get the Nobel Prize. It became important to achieve high angular resolution at this stage. How do you achieve high angular resolution? Well, lambda by d, so build bigger and bigger telescope. You can't build bigger and bigger radio telescope, there are structural difficulties. So what you could do is the following. You could build an interferometer which consists of dishes. You can put them on a railway track, move them around, so you have different spacings between them. And then do something terribly clever. You are the quasar and you are looking at the Earth. On the Earth, somewhere here in Cambridge, there is an interferometer. And as the Earth rotates, the interferometer, the projected interferometer will be like this. So it is almost as though you had a radio telescope which was that big. And so that led to the idea of the rotational synthesis that Martin Ryle discovered. GMRT is a rotational synthesis telescope. In GMRT, you have 30 antennas distributed around 32 kilometers in the form of a letter Y. So imagine as the Earth rotates, the configuration of the Y will change with respect to the distant star. And therefore, GMRT will appear as though it is a radio telescope of a diameter of 32 kilometers if you integrate the signal over 12-hour period, okay? Because you need fancy computers and so on to do it. There's no problem today doing that. So it is for that idea that Martin Ryle was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics. Now, the first rotational synthesis telescope that was ever built was the one in Cambridge. I had the good fortune, when I went to work in Cambridge, I wanted to see this radio telescope, and I went there one day, and there was this man standing on a ladder doing something with it. He said, "What do you want?" "I would like to have a tour of this telescope." He showed me around. Then only later on I discovered that he was Martin Ryle. I didn't know he was Martin Ryle. So I just reached Cambridge, and this was one of the first results from this 1 mile long interferometer. Then he went on to build a 5 kilometer long interferometer, and GMRT, of course, is much bigger. It's 32 kilometer baseline. All right. Now at that stage, this was around the time I had gone to work in Cambridge. Martin Rees, very young man at the time, now very famous, he's an astronomer royal. Till recently, he was the president of the Royal Society, master of Trinity College, and the Plumian professor of astronomy, which was the chair that Eddington had a long time ago. He and one of his terribly clever students, Roger Blanford, advanced the idea that these radio lobes that Martin Ryle had detected in Cygnus A are produced by two jets from the central objects, and these jets are relativistic jets. So this was the argument. There was no jet in that picture, you notice that. There is no jet. So the idea was that there is a relativistic jet from the central object, which is the elliptical galaxy Cygnus A, and that's what is producing all the action over there. So the idea was that the two hotspots in the radio lobes, you notice that in both the radio lobes, there is a hotspot over there where the intensity is maximum. these contours are iso-intensity curves, as usual. These hot spots correspond to the place where the ramp pressure of the jet is equal to the ramp pressure of the intergalactic medium. Okay? Just as in a supernova remnant, the radio emission was maximum when the ramp pressure of the shock wave, the interaction between the supernova blast wave and the interstellar medium. Now, how are these lobes created? If I take a hose pipe and water and show it towards the wall, there'll be a hot spot over there, and there'll be a spray over here. And the idea was that it is this backflow which is responsible for the radio lobe. What is responsible for the radiation itself? It is the relativistic electrons and the magnetic field carried by the jet from the central body and deposited millions of light years away. The radiation is synchrotron radiation like in supernova remnants, and the enhanced emission at the edges of the lobe is due to Bose shock. Here, the acceleration of the particles, the compression of the magnetic field and synchrotron radiation is reminiscent of supernova remnants that we spoke about. And finally, the jet was found. This was in the beginning of 1980s, some 10 years after the prediction was made. The relativistic jet from the central object was discovered. Now, these jets are extremely collimated. And this picture shows that. Here is the galaxy Cygnus. This is the radio lobes on the two sides. And right at the center is the elliptical galaxy Cygnus A. And if I look at that region in an expanded form, and that red arrow is 37,000 light years, so that gives you a scale for this jet. I look in the central region even expanded. Here it's only 270 light years. And I expand that, and here it's a mere 10 light years. So you see, from scales of the order of 1 or 2 light years to about 1 million light years, this jet is absolutely collimated. Now, if I take a fireman's hose pipe, it'll only be collimated for about 1 or 2 meters. Afterwards, the water will expand. The question is, how is this jet collimated for millions of light years? And during the process, the jet is emitting radiation. Therefore, the particles are losing energy. So the jet has to continuously re-accelerate particles. Otherwise, these electrons are tired by the time they go out to million parsecs from the central object. Okay? So these are problems that still remain to be solved satisfactorily. Here are some examples of other jets. Here is the galaxy Centaurus A. You notice all these jets are associated with elliptical galaxies and not with spiral galaxies. Here is a granddaddy of elliptical galaxies, Centaurus A, and you see a radio jet. This is the optical galaxy, and you notice it's perpendicular to the equatorial belt of this galaxy. Now here is Centaurus A, same thing. This, on the top left-hand corner, you have the visible galaxy. And in the bottom, you see the radio jet. And this is the infrared image. And what you see here is the spectacular X-ray jet taken with the Chandra X-ray Observatory. So this jet is seen not only in radio emission, but in X-ray emission. And the X-ray jet is collimated, collinear with the radio jet. Okay, so there's really a lot of action taking place. Here is some other galaxy, NGC 383. It's a quasar, and you see this inner portion of the jet has been expanded over here. You see this jet, there are wiggly things there, indicating that the jet may be precessing. Here is the jet around the quasar 3C31. 3C, 3/34. And you notice that in some of these galaxies, you see only one side of the jet and you don't see the other side of the jet. Now, I don't have time to go into this now. I actually made the slides and removed it because I knew I wouldn't have time. This proves that the jets are relativistic. Now, when motion is relativistic, you not only have Doppler effect of frequencies, in other words, redshift from your side, redshift and blueshift, but it also has implication for the observed intensities. Okay? Intensity is related to the number of photons per unit time. And if the motion is relativistic, the rate of ticking of that clock is different from the rate of ticking of your clock. In the second lecture, when I introduced the idea of brightness or specific intensity, I knew, I gave it as an exercise for you to convince yourself that I knew over nu cubed is a Lorentz invariant. Therefore, Doppler, the relativistic motion has effect not only on frequencies but also on intensities. It's very easy to show that the intensity coming of the jet coming towards you will be enhanced by many factors, whereas this one will be diminished by a very large factor. And so an interpretation of a one-sided jet is the jet that you see is the one that is coming towards you, and the jet you don't see is the one that's going towards, I mean, away from you. This is called Doppler favoritism, okay? And the reason why I chose not to do that is I want to come to something related to that, and that is superluminal motion. When Martin Rees and Blanford advanced the idea that there must be relativistic jets, they said straight away that some jets will be one-sided due to Doppler favoritism. And they also said that if you see fine structure in the jet, you will see them expanding faster than the speed of light, superluminal motion. Okay, this was a prediction that was made long before observations, about 10 years or 12 years before observations. Let's try to understand this. So please look at this algebra with some care. It's very simple algebra, and I want you to appreciate this carefully. Imagine that there is a black hole at position A. And imagine this black hole, which is at the center of my elliptical galaxy, ejecting a blob. And let that blob be ejected along the direction AB with a velocity V. And I am here at the bottom, the observer, looking at this black hole and the blob that has been ejected at an angle theta to the line of sight. The distance traveled by the blob, the physical distance traveled by the blob in time delta t, is the distance AB, which is V times delta t. But it will appear to us that the blob in the sky, it will appear to us that the blob has traveled the distance V delta t sine theta from projected point A to the projected point B. When did the signal from A reach us? Let us say that the signal was emitted at a certain time. It takes the time d divided by c, or t1. T1 is the time taken for signal from A to reach us. When was the signal from B emitted? A time delta t later. But when the signal was emitted at a time delta t later, B was closer to us than A by this amount, which is V delta T cos theta. Therefore, T2, the time at which I will receive the signal emitted by B, is delta T plus D minus V delta T cos theta divided by the speed of light. This can be simplified. And if I introduce beta, which is V by C, the conventional notation, then I find that the apparent velocity of the blob in the sky, beta apparent, is beta sin theta divided by 1 minus beta cos theta. Okay, no tricks, simple kinematics, nothing fancy. So that formula is reproduced here on the top for your convenience, as is the figure. Now let us fix beta. Beta is the speed with which the blob is ejected by this black hole. Then the apparent speed in the sky is function of theta. I can maximize this as a function of theta. And it's very easy to show, differentiate and set equal to zero and so on. You find that the maximum of the apparent beta will happen when cos theta is equal to beta. And the maximum apparent velocity will be equal to gamma times beta, where gamma is the well-known 1 over square root of 1 minus b squared by c squared. So what we are saying is, I'm emitting the blob in that direction, but to you it appears the blob is moving from here to there, and that velocity will be equal to gamma times beta. So if the blob is ejected at relativistic speeds, namely if gamma is very large, then gamma times beta can be much greater than 1. And that is superluminal motion. So that is shown in this figure here. What is plotted on the y-axis is beta, or apparent beta, v over c, as a function of this angle theta, where theta is the angle between the direction in which the blob is moving and the line of sight. This angle is theta. So you see, as the velocity of the blob is increased, the apparent transverse velocity can reach 6 beta, 10 beta, I mean 10 times the speed of light, 15 times the speed of light, and so on. So this was a prediction made by Blanford and Rees long time before. And here, the cover of Nature in 1981 is the superluminal motion from the quasar 3C273, which is the first quasar to have been discovered. So this is superluminal motion. These blobs appear to us to be moving at speed greater than the speed of light. It's a proof of relativistic jets. Here is the superluminal motion of the jet of another giant elliptical galaxy, M87. Here is another quasar, 3C273. You see a different epoch, 1993 to 1995. You see the blob. This is the apparent motion. But you notice that this motion is in 5 milli arc seconds. So to achieve an angular resolution of a milli arc second itself is a spectacular angular resolution, milli arc second, is not enough to have a telescope like the GMRT with a baseline of 32 kilometers. You need a baseline of 5,000 kilometers or 10,000 kilometers. So the interferometer that is used for this observation are intercontinental interferometers. A telescope in Hawaii, a telescope in California, a telescope in Bonn, a telescope in Ooty, all working as an interferometer. In the olden days, what you do is you take the tape from computer tapes. Tapes, you people have never heard of tapes, right? Come to a central laboratory, and then you have to synchronize the clocks. So go from one place to another with a hydrogen maser, which was as big as a room. There's one in the Russians brought to the Ooty, which I've kept in Raman Institute in the terrace, built a shed. It's about 2 meters by 2 meters by 3 meters. Today I forgot my phone. So today, of course, inside this, you have a GPS receiver. So you don't need hydrogen masers. You have cesium clocks going around. So today it is, these people struggle with hydrogen masers and so on. But today this is very easy. GMRT and Ooty telescope are routinely used along with other telescopes. It's called VLBI, very long baseline interferometer. Okay. So I think you must be now convinced there is enough evidence to say that these jets that energize the hotspots and the radio lobes are indeed relativistic. Problems remain how to collimate the jet and how to re-accelerate particles in the jet. Now, this phenomena of jets and superluminal motion is not just restricted to quasars, they are also found in stellar mass objects. Here is a galactic source, it's a gamma ray source, 1915 plus 105, those are the coordinates, and you see superluminal motion again, cover of nature, 1994. So here is the original galaxy Cygnus A, now a multi-wavelength image. There is the central galaxy of Bode and Minkowski. Here are the optical hotspots, synchrotron emission. The red is the radio lobes. And this blue thing, which I saw for the first time preparing this lecture, is the Chandra X-ray image of Cygnus A, which I didn't know about. So there is this 10 million degree gas forming a halo. I never heard of this before, therefore I have no idea of where this gas came from. I need to think about it over the coming week. Some radio galaxies have very odd morphologies, like this one where the two jets are swept back. This is understood in terms of this galaxy occurring in a cluster of galaxies and moving in the cluster of galaxies. Just as there is an interstellar medium, there is a gas in the intra-cluster gas, and the ram pressure of the gas sweeps back the relativistic jet, and that's the idea of this. Now let's conclude by briefly discussing the energy content of these two radio lobes. Now, equipartition argument, somebody was supposed to ask me some question in the end. Was it you? Okay, so we'll come back to this. Equipartition argument. Let's not break the story at this stage. Now, what you could do is to say this lobe is filled with electrons and magnetic field, which is producing the synchrotron emission. And you make a hand-waving argument that the energy in the magnetic field is roughly equal to the energy in relativistic particles, which is the equipartition argument. If you do that, you find that the total energy in each lobe is 10 to the power 61 ergs. Now the central engine, which you see, has a luminosity of only 10 to the power 46 or 10 to the power 47 ergs. That means that in order to account for 10 to the power 61 ergs in the two radio lobes, I must convince myself that this relativistic jet has been depositing energy for 100 million years. So there is a spectacular problem now. Whatever is the central body that's producing this jet must produce this jet for 100 million years. And this jet must not wander around. It must be absolutely stable. Okay? So, the problems are getting, the list is getting longer and longer. What confines and collimates the jets? What is responsible for the continuous reacceleration in the jet? Now the central engine has a luminosity of 10 to the power 46, 47 ergs. It's generally a quasar, which stands for quasi-stellar radio source. But sometimes the central object doesn't emit radio waves, but it emits X-rays, optical and so on. Now you notice that the luminosity of the sun is only 10 to the power 33 ergs. The luminosity of a star 10 times the mass of the sun will be m cube. Luminosity goes as m cube, so it will be 1,000 solar luminosity, which is 10 to the power 36. Therefore, to produce 10 to the power 46 arcs per second, the central object must be equivalent of 10 to the power 10 stars. To put it differently, to produce a luminosity of 10 to the power 46 arcs per second, the central body must have a mass of at least 1 billion solar mass, 10 to the power 9 solar mass. How do I say that? Because I don't know what the object is. I don't know what is producing the radiation. So I would like to end this lecture by telling you about this. To me, it's one of the most beautiful concepts in astrophysics. And like many things, can be traced back to Eddington. Let's go back to our third lecture, the stars, Eddington's theory of the stars. Let's revisit that. So what is shown here is a gaseous star. In inward pull of gravity, which is the red arrows, is balanced by the outward pressure of gas and radiation. Now, I said, radiation pressure is not very important for the sun, only 8 or 10%, but Eddington said, no, calm down, keep radiation pressure because it's going to become more and more important in more massive stars. So let us imagine that we are dealing with a massive star, 20 solar mass star, let us say, 30 solar mass. So radiation pressure is more important than gas pressure. So the yellow arrows represent radiation pressure. Like in the equation of hydrostatic equilibrium derivation, let us consider a unit volume of stellar material over there, a little cube of stellar material. Now, I'm going to invoke Eddington's idea of radiative equilibrium. Since gas pressure is not very important now compared to radiation pressure, I have to find the condition that the pressure due to radiation, which is trying to blow away that little mass, I have to compare that with the gravitational pull of that due to the central mass. Now let us first calculate what is the radiative force on that unit volume. Let us say the luminosity generated in the center is capital L. And let us say that this unit volume is at a distance small r from the center. Therefore, it is sitting on the surface of a sphere of radius r, whose surface area is 4 pi r squared. Convince yourself that the pressure is L divided by 4 pi r squared times C. Okay? Luminosity is energy per time. C will give me distance divided by time. So if you think about it, you will get a force. And this is acting on n electrons inside that unit cube. Let us say there are n electrons inside that and n protons. But I know that protons don't interact very effectively with radiation. Only electrons do. Remember, we discussed Thomson scattering. It's simply because protons are 2,000 times heavier. And the cross-section of each electron is the Thomson scattering cross-section, sigma Thomson. Therefore, the total cross-section of the electrons in this unit volume is n times sigma Thomson scattering. Therefore, the total radiative force on that unit volume is given by that expression. And that has to be equated to the gravitational force acting on that, which is shown in the next slide. First, what is this Thomson scattering cross-section? In case I didn't say it in the third lecture, here it is. The Thomson scattering cross-section is 8 pi by 3 square of the classical radius of the electron. Remember, this is not the radius of the electron, but it is a notional radius. And what is that value of the radius? It is that value where the electrostatic energy E squared by R is equal to the rest mass energy of the electron mc squared. You've studied about this, I'm sure. So that is the Thomson scattering cross section. What is the gravitational force on the unit volume? Please remember, photons talk only to the electrons, but gravity talks only to the protons for the same reason. So I can ignore the masses of the electrons. Therefore, the gravitational force is Gm of r, which is the mass interior to the circle. Number of protons must be equal to the number of electrons multiplied by the mass of the protons. So for radiative equilibrium, Gm mp by r squared must be equal to L divided by 4 pi r squared c multiplied by the Thomson scattering cross section. I can solve this equation for the luminosity, and you find a remarkable expression that the luminosity is 4 pi c g mp by sigma Thomson, all determined by fundamental constants multiplied by the mass of the star. This luminosity is known as the Eddington luminosity. It is known as the Eddington luminosity limit. Because if the luminosity of a star were to exceed this value, then the star will be blown away by the pressure of the radiation. And this maximum luminosity is uniquely determined by the mass of the star. The radius and temperature do not come into it. It's a beautiful result. And only fundamental constants come into it. So if I now put in all these constants, this Eddington luminosity limit can be written as 10 to the power 38 erg per second multiplied by mass of the object measured in units of the mass of the sun. So for the sun, the Eddington luminosity limit is 10 to the power 38 erg per second. To have a luminosity of 10 to the power 46 or 47, I must have a body whose mass is 10 to the power 9 solar mass. This is an extremely powerful argument, because I'm saying I don't care what the central engine of that black hole is. It must have a mass of 10 to the 9 solar masses. Because whatever be the emission mechanism, the luminosity can never exceed this Eddington. This is not to say this will emit that, but it cannot emit that. It cannot exceed this. Therefore, the lower limit to the mass of the central engine is 10 to the 9 solar masses. Okay? Is that argument clear? So this Eddington luminosity limit comes up again and again and again and again. Now, I remember one day when I was a young student like you people in University of Chicago, and the year was 1968, a radio astronomer came and said, one of these quasars showed a variability. In other words, between last year and this year, its luminosity had changed. People almost fell out of their chairs. You can't have an object which is a galaxy whose luminosity changes over a year. Because please remember the argument that I gave you, Jocelyn Bell's argument. If the object varies in the time scale delta t, then its physical size cannot exceed c delta t. And that immediately gave the idea to several people, Chandrasekhar in Chicago, Feynman in Caltech, and Zeldovich in Moscow, that the central engine of these quasars must be a black hole. Because if you're going to put that much mass in that small a distance, it has to be a black hole. Now, if anybody doubted that argument at that time, a variability of a year or so, here is some recent data. You see that the variability, this is variability in this is variability in X-rays. This is ours. This is variability in TeV gamma rays, which is an... So variability time scale has come down from a year to months to weeks to hours now. So the object, the limiting size of the object has become smaller and smaller and smaller, and therefore the argument it must be a black hole is more and more compelling. Okay? Therefore, there is unanimity now of the picture that has emerged that quasars as well as other type of active galactic nuclei such as Cygnus X1, Cygnus A, and so on, are all powered by supermassive black holes. And with the advent of Chandra Observatory, it has emerged that all galaxies harbor supermassive black holes at the center, including our own galaxy. Its mass is only 3 million solar mass, not 3 billion solar mass. But our galaxy is not a quasar. So the question arises, if all galaxies are supermassive black holes at their centers, why some function as quasars, why others don't function as quasars? Martin Rees provided a conjecture long time ago, namely, these black holes, like in the center of our galaxy, are starved of matter. Black holes don't emit radiation. It is only the gravitational binding energy of matter falling into the black hole that comes out. So gas and stars are not falling into the black hole. It will not be a very luminous thing. So the phenomenon of quasar emission may be something that turns on and off in a galaxy depending upon what's happening right near the center. Now, if you take the stars in the very central region of the black hole, near the black hole, they could be tidally disrupted. So if a star comes very close to the black hole, it can be tidally disrupted. Some gas can fall into the black hole, and some energy can escape during the process of falling in, okay? In every case, matter has to first form an accretion disk around the black hole, because the star that is being tidally disrupted is going around the black hole, so it has angular momentum. So since matter has angular momentum, it cannot flow in radially. It'll form a disk like the rings of Saturn, and then friction has to slowly take the matter to make it fall in. And the efficiency of converting the potential energy into radiation is only about 10% for a black hole, if at all, because the black hole doesn't have a hard surface like a neutron star. In the case of a neutron star, the matter can hit the surface of the neutron star, heat it, and that can radiate. So in the black hole, it just swallows it up. So it is less efficient in converting gravitational potential energy into radiation. So a luminous quasar has to accrete several solar mass of material every year. And remember, you may be very generous and saying, look, take it, I'm giving you all the matter you can. But if you throw in more matter, it will emit more radiation, and that radiation will prevent further infall, Eddington again. There's a luminosity limit, right? So you can only grow the, you can only throw in mass subject to this luminosity limit of Eddington. And so it takes a long time to accrete matter. So the model that has emerged today is that there is a supermassive black hole at the centers of these galaxies. There is an accretion disk, which is the yellow disk, extending to very large distances. It is very thin. Right near the black hole, because the gas is very hot, the thin disk bloats up like a balloon due to radiation pressure. So you have these two bulging disk, thick accretion disk, very close to the black hole, and you have a beautiful funnel in the middle. So the idea is that these jets are somehow collimated in that funnel that you see above and below the equatorial plane, created by the thick accretion disk. Now, there are all kinds of active galaxies. There are quasars, there are blazars, there are Seyfert galaxies, there is Seyfert 1, there is Seyfert 2. They all have different things. Some emit radio emission, some the emission lines are broad, some the emission lines are narrow, absorption lines are narrow. So there is a zoo of active galactic nuclei. So when I first taught myself some astronomy to be able to teach students when we started astronomy program here 30 years ago, there was a zoo of theories. Now that's all disappeared. there is now a beautiful unified model. The unified model is what is shown in this picture here. It's a thin disk which is puffed up near the black hole. There are clouds of gas all over the place. And you are viewing it from all possible geometries. So here is the black hole. There is a disk and there is a torus. There are all these clouds. And you may be seeing it from that direction, the North Pole, or some other direction in the equatorial plane. Depending on your viewing angle, you will see broad emission lines or narrow emission lines, radio emission or no radio emission, X radiation or no X radiation, because hydrogen cloud in the intervening line of sight will absorb X rays by photoelectric absorption. So you won't see soft X rays. So this is called as a unified model. So I'm not going to go into the zoo or the detailed explanation, but if somebody asks you, what is a quasar, what is a galactic nuclei, you can say, it is a supermassive black hole with an accretion disk, which is thick near the black hole and thin far away. There are clouds of gas all over the place. Depending on the viewing angle, you see different manifestations. Okay? So I think that's a good point to stop and ask if there are any questions on this very rapid tour of the realm of the galaxies. But I'm afraid I had to do this because only two lectures left, and I want to do the cosmology thing a little more slowly and a little more systematically. Are there any questions?
Hello.
Yes.
Thank you, sir, for the fantastic talk. So,
again, pause.
Yes. I would really like if you illuminate a bit on how the spiral structure is formed for spiral galaxy.
Yeah, so if I there is somebody up there, I can't see them. I may need some help. Yeah, I'll do that. I think I may have. Yeah, in fact, I had some slides, I removed them. So the question now is, why do some galaxies have spiral structures? It's a very complicated subject, and I'll tell you what little I know about it. As I said, when I showed the Hubble's classification of galaxies, not all spiral structures look like this. Some spiral galaxies have a bar in the center. Keep that in mind. The first thing to appreciate is that the spiral structure, spiral arms of a galaxy are not made of identifiable objects. Imagine, here is a galaxy, and I draw a spoke here, and I put four objects here, four objects there. Stick them with Fevicol. Now, I make the galaxy rotate differentially. So I hope you will agree that this beautiful spoke will be wound up. And every time the galaxy rotates once, there'll be one winding of the spiral. So if the galaxy rotates once in 250 million years, we have had lots of time, you should have 10, 15, 20 arms of a spiral, which you don't find. You find two or three or four. So this suggests that whatever is delineating the spiral arms are mere traces, and they are not physically attached to this. So what you're really witnessing is a spiral density wave. And as the density wave goes, imagine that there are ping pong balls on a lake, all floating, and I create a spiral wave. Exactly at the location of the spiral wave, you'll find the ping pong balls go up and down. But as the spiral wave goes, there's a different ping pong balls going up and down. But a distant observer will always find ping pong balls associated with the spiral wave. So that is the first thing. But then the question is, why does this spiral wave arise? Spiral density wave arise. Let us first consider the mean motion of a test particle in the disk. Please wait for a minute. I need some help with you. I have a YouTube video. You can, the other room somehow managed to show it. Because I put this in my pen drive, in the host computer, it would show it. So here, see if you can do that. Okay. So here is an unperturbed disk. Now imagine that in the central region of the galaxy, for some reason, there is a bar-like structure. That bar-like structure will produce a gravitational perturbation, which will have a certain azimuthal symmetry. In this case, if it is m equal to 2, so that will be different from that, will be different from that, will be different from this. Okay? Then it will repeat again. And let us assume that bar is rotating with an angular velocity omega p, where p stands for the pattern. So that bar is rotating. So I'm looking at it from outside. So what I'll find is that the stars are not only going around the center due to their mutual gravity, but there is a gravitational perturbation which is periodic in the azimuthal angle and also periodic in time. Just imagine that. Okay? So, to be specific, let us go to a frame of reference which is rotating with an angular velocity, which is the difference between this angular velocity and the angular velocity of this pattern, omega minus omega p. So if I go to that frame of reference, I will only see the differential motion with respect to this, okay? So it is in that frame of reference that the subsequent pictures are drawn. So now, look at the picture at the bottom left-hand corner. What are shown in these ovals, first to appreciate, is that the motion of the test particle around the galaxy will not be circular now, but will be an oval-shaped thing because of this gravitational perturbation. Okay? But this oval will be stationary because that's not shown from the inertial frame, but I've gone to the frame which is co-rotating. Yeah, okay, fine. But now you notice that these different ovals are oriented in a completely random fashion, and so there is no spiral pattern or any pattern here. The motion is random. Now let us turn on a little bit of conspiracy. Now imagine that the angular phase, see the perturbation that I introduce, F1, is A cos M phi. This perturbation is same at all radial distances. If it is the same at all radial distances, then all these ovals will be aligned with one another. And I will have this pattern over here. Again, there is no spiral. It's just that the pattern is not completely random, but it is aligned ovals. Now I introduce a radial dependence to this. I introduce a dependence cos m phi minus a certain phi of r, which is a radial dependence of this azimuthal perturbation. And then you'll find a beautiful, sorry, I keep pressing the wrong thing. Now you'll find a beautiful two-arm spiral, simply because there is a phase shift between the major axis of one oval and the next oval and the next oval and the next oval. And what appears as a spiral here is merely a congestion of the let's call it the tip of these ellipses. I think I have a better picture to show this. Okay, so let's read what it says here, to repeat what I just said. Now, recent studies suggest that the wave action works not by literally pushing the stars together, but by subtly choreographing their orbits. Here, there is no choreography. As the stars trundle around the galaxy on an ellipse or an oval, the ellipse itself is moving. This secondary motion is the raw material for the density wave. So here in A, there is no wave. In B, there is a two-arm spiral wave. And remember, in the inertial frame of reference, this spiral arm will be now rotating. If that is in a frame of reference, I've jumped to where the relative angular velocity, where the pattern velocity has been taken out. Now, please bear with me and let's read this. Bar wave arises when orbits align as shown in the, how did the central bar align, come about in the first place? So it's a chicken and egg. You say somehow or other, in the central region of the galaxies, a bar wave appears. In other words, these oval orbits are rigidly locked to one another, and there is a bar. Now, let's look at the bottom picture. The spiral wavefront is an area of the greater star density. Let us say that these lines really correspond to various stars. So the spiral wave really corresponds to greater star density, which occurs along the major axis of the ellipses. You notice? Everywhere is the major axis of the ellipse, okay? Spiral wave arises when the ellipses move in unison but are not perfectly aligned. Each ellipse is slightly skewed compared with its neighbor. The density of stars is highest where the ellipses crowd together, as shown in the diagram C. Diagram D shows that the barred spiral pattern, when orbits near the center of the galaxy are aligned, but those further out are skewed, it is thought that the alignment is caused by the spontaneous gravitational instability. Now, here is the important thing in yellow at the bottom. Because the gravity in a galaxy is not fixed external force, but product of the stars themselves, the density wave can be reinforcing, self-reinforcing. In other words, the density wave has to be a normal mode of the system. Otherwise, it will not be long-lived. You want it to last for billions of years. So the spiral density wave has to be a normal mode. Okay? Now, this idea was first advanced by Bertil Lindblad, the same person who discovered galactic differential rotation. That was in 1923. He was still very intellectually not only alive but very active many decades later. And this was developed by C.C. Lin and Frank Shu the following year. But that was all long old story. But now people have realized that it is not just the stars that matter. You also need to bring in the interstellar medium. Because, see, stars are collisionless systems. So you need a fluid. So the moment you bring in an interstellar medium, then it is more amenable to a fluid-like description. The problem has not been solved as yet in the sense that, you know, Chandrasekhar didn't write a book on it. That means the problem hasn't been solved. But where are the challenges? The challenges are to find this function A of R and phi of R. A of R cos m phi minus phi of R. You have to find A of R and phi of R so that this spiral pattern is the normal mode of the galaxy. Self-stabilized normal modes. The problem is still, that is as far as I could understand, okay? Now, why is this arising in the first place? Somebody asked me some time ago in the blackboard outside, I tried to say, if you take an accretion disk around the black hole or a neutron star, it radiates because matter from the accretion disk falls in. That means matter in the accretion disk slowly spirals in and falls. As it goes in, its angular momentum will increase. And as its angular momentum increases, it will try to go back. So you can't bring matter in unless you take away the angular momentum increase by coming in. So in an accretion disk around a neutron star or a black hole, this is very beautiful. Not only matter falling in, the matter is also coming out at the outer edges. Otherwise, angular momentum conservation will be violated. Same thing is happening here. Now, because the galaxy is rotating differentially, this coming in motion and going out motion is not happening radially, but it's happening as a spiral. So what you need to have, this is what I've been able to synthesize for myself, is that you need differential rotation and you need some instability which drives this. Without differential rotation, I convinced myself you can't get this, okay? So this is what I want to show. Now, let me see, I don't think it'll work, but it may be, let's see now. Watch the left, please. Put it again. I have to stop this now. How do I stop it? Now, there are two pictures there. Watch the left one now. The spiral is getting more and more wound. So that's not a spiral density wave. There are identifiable matters stuck to the pattern, okay? So that's what you don't see. Galaxies with the... So can you now play this back? Where do you... Now look at the one on the right. I'll show this again in the next video. You'll see detailed motion in the spiral arm. You will see different stars. So now watch this carefully. Let's play it twice. Now I want you to see how the stars are coming into the spiral arm and going out of the spiral arm. That tells you different stars are doing that. Also notice stars are moving out. You see the stars. So that is the angular momentum being taken away. That's what I said, angular momentum is being taken away because as stars come into the central region, this angular momentum is to go out. So this clearly shows, each time there are different, see these stars are coming in and then going out. But the pattern itself is stationary. I discovered this by accident because you had asked a question the other day. I searched a little bit and I myself not seen anything like this. Fantastic, incredible simulation. Okay, so thank you very much. Yes. Yes.
Initial part of your talk, you told that in the thick component of the disk, some stars which were born on the disk migrated upwards.
Yeah.
What made you assume that they were all the stars are born on the disk itself?
No, I said that because if you remember in the last lecture, I said that molecular gas is confined to a very thin disk of only about 60 parsec thickness on either side. Stars are born from molecular clouds. So I expect stars, particularly the massive stars which come from molecular clouds, to be born in the disk of the galaxy because that's where the molecular clouds are. Then they can migrate out over. This is related to Fermi acceleration of cosmic rays. In any given, it's like the random walk of a drunkard man. He goes back and forth, but he's always moving away from the place where he started, right? And this is guaranteed to you by second law of thermodynamics, if you like, because if you look at the differential equation of motion, it is diffusion equation. Okay. So, you remember some other context I said, how are cosmic rays produced? Fermi first said, due to collision with clouds. Now, electrons cannot collide with a cloud. They collide with a magnetic field, which is frozen into the cloud. So magnetic field acts like a mirror. So in every collision, in a head-on collision, electron can gain energy. But in a collision, tail collision, it can lose energy. So whether there is a net gain or not depends upon whether the frequency of head-on collision is more than the frequency of being hit from the back. Understand? So it was very unsatisfactory. Then Fermi came up with this definitive argument, which is stochastic acceleration. He said that like in any collision, energy increase or decrease. So in energy space, you're doing a random walk. And second law of thermodynamics guarantees that there is an irreversibility, energy will always increase. So in a stochastic process, energy will always increase. So these stars, as they go around, massive stars don't go around because it takes 250 million years to go around. They only live for 10, 15 million years. So they die pretty soon after they're born. The only stars that go around are the low mass stars. And they go around many times. As they go around, they suffer collision, not physical collision, but gravitational collisions with passing by molecular clouds and so on, because of differential rotation of the galaxy. They're either overtaken by a molecular cloud or they overtake molecular cloud. So there are these collisions. In these collisions, they either gain energy or lose energy. But a la Fermi, statistically, they will gain in energy. So in other words, they get heated up. So even a thin population of low mass stars over many rotations will become a thick one because it's like hot gas. Hot and cold here, we don't mean physical temperature, but the Boltzmann distribution of the atmosphere, e to the minus mgh over kt, we put, right, in terms of the density. So how far a star climbs up from the galactic disk depends upon how much kinetic energy it has, isn't it? So I'm using temperature in that sense. Understand? So you should understand low mass stars puffing up because of, say, something like a Fermi stochastic acceleration. Does that answer your question? Massive stars don't live, that's all. They live for a very short time. A 10 solar mass star lives only for about 10 million years. It's nothing, right? Yeah. Any other question? Let's go back to your original question. You know, when we are taught in our colleges, you're all studying, theoretical physics is associated with mathematics, right? Usually some second-rate mathematics, not even first-rate mathematics. There's this tremendous confusion between mathematics and physics, right? And if you read something like Landau and Lipschitz, it's highly mathematical. Actually, a lot of people would consider Landau and Lipschitz as very lowbrow mathematics. And that's because Landau deals with it in one of the early volumes. In the preface, he says, mathematical rigor is irrelevant for theoretical physics. Okay? Mathematical rigor is nothing whatsoever. So here I'm going to tell you what I consider as one of the most sublime examples of theoretical physics. Okay? is related to some question that you asked and also somebody else asked. So after the Second World War ended, if you permit me to say it like a story, then only it has a certain value. People, in particular Fermi, returned to physics. So around 1946 or so, Fermi decided he will get interested in astrophysics because money was still scarce to build an accelerator, things like that, just after the war. So he thought, let's go to some other subject. So his deal was that every Thursday morning, Chandrasekhar would go to Fermi's office first thing in the morning. And the deal was that every Thursday morning, Chandrasekhar would tell Fermi some new result in astrophysics, not new, new to him. Some well-known result, sorry, not new, some well-known result in astrophysics. So I've heard this story from Chandrasekhar himself. Apparently there used to be only one chalk piece in Fermi's room, in the board, Fermi Institute, and he always had it in his pocket, in his hand. So anytime something, he would go to the board. So when he stole something, he'll go to the board and say, Chandra, I will tell you this result is wrong. You never heard of this result, and he'll say this result is wrong. And then he'll go to the board and try to explain why this result is wrong. You see, this implies this, this implies this, and some stage he'll stop. His process of proving this result wrong has failed. And he has suddenly understood the result. Okay, so this was Fermi's way of understanding anything. You tell me something, I'll show you this wrong, and in the process, if I fail, I have understood if it is correct. But Chandrasekhar also told me on a number of occasions when he didn't stop and went on to show some well-known result was actually wrong. Yeah. So, one of those Thursday mornings, Fermi asked Chandrasekhar, does the galaxy have a magnetic field? Chandrasekhar said, one doesn't know. One didn't know. Fermi said, look, galaxy must have a magnetic field. I'll tell you why. He said, look, cosmic rays, the year was 1946 or so, cosmic rays are produced in discrete locations. They come from there or there or there. But on Earth, that cosmic rays are isotropic. Actually, they are not. That's because of the magnetic field of the Earth. But if you go in balloons above the magnetic field, it's isotropic. Okay? So the distribution of cosmic rays is not coming from discrete directions, it's coming from all over the place. Like molecules in this air are hitting me from all directions with equal probability, right? So he says, how did these cosmic rays become isotropized? You can only isotropize particles if you make them collide inside a box. So I can make cosmic rays rattle around. They come from there, or there, or there, or there. But once inside the box, I make them rattle around for millions of years, and then the distribution will become isotropic. Now, what kind of box has to be? Only thing that can deflect a cosmic ray particle is a magnetic field. You see, galaxy must have a magnetic field. But then he didn't stop. He said, look, if the magnetic field is very strong, namely, if the energy density of the magnetic field is much larger than the energy density of the particle, then the magnetic field will dictate. He'll say, no, it can't. You can't cross me, V cross V force. So what you will see is not an isotropic distribution, but what you will see is an image of the magnetic field itself. It's like if I put a bar magnet and sprinkle iron filings, I see the pattern of the magnetic field lines, right? But if the magnetic field is too weak, then it won't, the particles will disobey it. Therefore, there has to be an equipartition. Equipartition between the energy density of the particles and the energy density of the magnetic field. What is the energy density of the particles? He said, I know, I have measured it. It is 1 electron volt per cubic centimeter. That is the energy density of the cosmic rays from observation. He said this has to be equal to b squared over 8 pi. That immediately gives me a b of the order of a micro Gauss. And then they discovered polarization of the starlight. And the explanation that the dust grains are all aligned due to the magnetic field. And so people estimated the magnetic field. It was 10 to the power minus 6 Gauss. So I hope you will agree that this is one of the most sublime examples of theoretical physics. And I haven't used any equation. Obviously, when I say I, Fermi, right? So there was a famous paper by Fermi and Chandrasekhar in Astrophysical Journal on galactic magnetic field, followed by paper number Roman numeral 2, 3, 4, 5, which was only Chandrasekhar. Those are horrendous mathematical papers. But the paper with Fermi is beautiful. Look, you know, as Chandrasekhar said, that, you know, Fermi was an artist. He was not just he was an artist in science, right? So not everybody is gifted with that kind of intuition. So Chandrasekhar's papers would be full of magnetohydrodynamics and so on. That's why I probably never read any of his papers. Not possible to. Although his papers are written very beautifully. In other words, one or two that I have read, everything will be worked out, unlike in modern papers. Every step will be, you don't have to have a pad with you to work out things. Everything will be worked out, like in old-fashioned books, you know. So, this equipartition argument was, like Feynman, we know Feynman always used path integrals as a way to, variational principle to every problem. He would reduce to this. So, for example, in the 1930, when Fermi was trying to capture neutrons to transmutate elements, for which he was awarded the Nobel Prize, you needed to slow down neutrons, because neutrons produced in a radioactive source, they have very high energies, 14 MeV, 15 MeV, but only thermal neutrons can be absorbed by some of the nucleus. So he had a brilliant bunch of young students. He himself was same age as his students. There was Rossetti, there was Segre, they were all geniuses. And this would all happen in Fermi's. I don't know how many of you have read this book. Please do. Please do, at least as a favor to me. This is a book which is called Atoms in the Family. I am told it's now available by Laura Fermi, Enrico Fermi's wife, whom I had the great privilege of meeting. Fermi was dead, long dead, but when I went to Chicago, but she was still alive, and she was the chairperson of a committee, Chicago Green and Clean, some environmental issues. So I worked in a committee. I got her to know. This is a book in which it's a story of Fermi, told by a magnificent book. So here they are. Fermi is doing this, thinking of this, thinking of that, machining this to put it in the path of the neutrons. Suddenly he goes to the dining room, and the table, there is a little bowl with goldfish in it. So he brings it to the garden and puts that water. Suddenly he realizes water has protons. protons, neutrons scatter very well. And so the best moderator for neutrons is water or paraffin. That's why nuclear reactors, the first nuclear reactor that was built in Trombay, that had seawater. So what happens? Equipartition. The fast neutrons collide, and after many collisions, they thermalize. And the velocity of the kT is same as the kT of this. So in so many different contexts, including in elementary particle physics, Fermi was to again and again and again invoke this equipartition argument. Okay.